In this lecture, I would like to discuss about the theories of the metal ligand bond in coordination compounds. Number of ligand molecules or ions are bonded to the metal atom. So what is the nature of the bond between the metal and the ligand? Many theories have been put forward to explain the nature of the bond between the metal and the ligands. There are so many theories are existing. In the syllabus of the SYBSC, we have been discussed about the valence bond theory. Now, in the syllabus of the TYBSC, the other two theories are given, that is crystal field theory and molecular orbital theory. Crystal field theory and molecular orbital theory. So on the basis of valence bond theory, the bond between the metal and the ligand, it is coordinate covalent bond. The bond between the metal and the ligand is coordinate covalent bond. The ligand molecules are donating their electron pairs to the metal atom. And metal atom or ion has the capacity to accept the electron pair from the ligand. Let us take the example. We know that on the basis of the valence bond theory, the bond between the metal and the ligand, it is coordinate covalent bond. The ligand molecules are donating the electron pair to the metal. So to accept the electron from the ligand, to accept the electron pair from the ligand, the metal atom or ion create the vacant orbitals for the accommodation of the electron pair donated by the ligands. In the valence shell of the metal atom, there should be the valence orbitals to accept the electron pair donated by the ligands. So that is the assumption of the valence bond theory. Now these vacant orbitals get hybridized. These vacant orbitals get hybridized. And on the basis of the hybridization, we can explain the geometry of the complex. So let us take the example of the complex ion CONH3+. CONH3+. So the name of the complex ion, it is hexamine cobalt third ion. Hexamine cobalt third ion. So on the basis of the valence bond theory, the bond between the cobalt 3+ ion and ammonia molecule, it is purely covalent bond. The six ammonia molecules donating the electron pairs to the central metal cobalt ion. And the central metal cobalt ion must have to create the vacant orbitals to accept the electron pair donated by the ammonia molecules. So let us show this. So cobalt have the atomic number 27, electronic configuration of the cobalt. Here argon 3d7 4s2. Now in this complex ion, as the oxidation state of the cobalt, it is 3+. So in tripositive oxidation state, the electronic configuration of the cobalt 3+ ion, it is 3d6 4h0. And next vacant orbital, it is 4p, that is 4p0. So on the basis of the valence bond theory, the metal atom create the vacant orbitals. Let us see how this will be. So cobalt 3+ ion having 3d orbital. So we can represent the arrangement here. There are six electrons. So six electrons can be represented in this way. Then 4s orbital, which is already vacant. And next it is 4p orbital. It is also vacant. 3p orbitals. Now to form the six covalent bonds, in this complex ion, we require 6 vacant orbitals. So there are only 4 vacant orbitals. Okay. So when 6 ammonia molecules are approaches to the central metal cobalt ion, they can create the force. These 6 ammonia molecules can create the force, and due to that force, the electrons get paired up into the lower lying orbitals. So the electronic configuration of the cobalt ion in excited state. So in excited state, the pairing of the electron is takes place. So let us show this. In excited state, the pairing of the electron it is takes place. So we can show this in this way. The electron get paired there in the 3D orbital. So now there are 2 orbitals are vacant, and these 4 other orbitals are already vacant there. So in this way, there are 6 vacant orbitals are available in the cobalt 3 plus ion. 2D orbital, 1s orbital, and 3p orbitals. So this is the electronic configuration of the cobalt 3 plus ion in the excited state. So in this way, the central metal ion create the vacant orbitals to accommodate the electron pairs donated by the ligands. So now the arrangement in the complex ion can be shown now. CONH3 6, 3 plus. So the ligand molecules donating the electron pairs in the vacant orbitals, and these vacant orbitals undergoes hybridization here. So 3D orbital, 4s orbital, and 4p orbital. So let us show the arrangement here. So in the vacant orbitals now, the electrons are donated by the ammonia molecules. So in these vacant orbitals, these electrons get accommodated, and there is a formation of coordinate covalent bond between the metal and the ligand. So as the coordination number is 6 here, so 6 covalent bonds are formed between the metal and the ligand, and the central cobalt ion undergoes d2sp3 hybridization. 2d orbitals, 1s orbital, and 3p orbitals are involved into the hybridization. So thus, on the basis of the valence bond theory, the cobalt 3 plus ion shows d2sp3 hybridization. And for d2sp3 hybridization, the corresponding geometry will be octahedral. The corresponding geometry will be octahedral. So thus, on the basis of the valence bond theory, we can explain the geometry of the complex. And we also explain the magnetic behavior of the complex. Magnetic behavior of the complex. So you can see here, as all the electrons are paired, the complex it is totally diamagnetic. No one unpaired electron is there. So thus, on the basis of the valence bond theory, we can explain the magnetic behavior as well as geometry of the complex. So valence bond theory explains the nature of the bond between the metal and the ligand. So thus, on the basis of the VBT, the bond between the metal and the ligand, it is purely covalent or coordinate covalent bond. So valence bond theory has explained very well the bonding between the metal and the ligand. But it could not explain other properties of the complexes. So let us see, what are the limitations of the valence bond theory? What are the limitations of valence bond theory? So the first limitation is that it fails to explain and interpret spectral and color properties of transition metal ions. This is the serious drawback of the valence bond theory. No doubt, valence bond theory very well explained the nature of the bond between the metal and the ligand. It explained the geometry of the complex. It explained the magnetic properties of the complex, magnetic properties of the coordination compounds. But it could not explain, or it could not interpret, the spectral and color properties of the transition metal complexes or transition metal ions. Second thing, it fails to explain why the complexes of the metal ions are low spin or high spin complexes. It is known that some complexes are low spin, some complexes are high spin complex. For example, CONH3CH3 plus, this complex is a low spin complex. And COF6-3 minus, hexafluorocobaltate third ion and hexaamine cobalt third ion. So first one, it is a low spin complex. Second one, it is a high spin complex. But how? It could not give any specific reason. Why CONH3CH3 plus it is a low spin complex? And why COF6-3 minus is a high spin complex? So this is the drawback of the valence bond theory. Then also another drawback, it fails to explain why some four orbital complexes are tetrahedral or square planar. Generally, the four orbital complex or coordination number four, ZnNH3-4-2 plus. Now this complex is a tetrahedral complex, but why? Coordination number is same. In this case also coordination number is four. But this complex is a square planar complex. So valence bond theory could not explain such variation in the properties of the complexes. Then it fails to explain certain geometries like tetragonal and distorted octahedral geometries. The octahedral complex get distorted. But valence bond theory could not explain how the distortion takes place in case of the octahedral complexes. Another drawback is that it fails to explain higher values of the magnetic moments. Some complexes are highly paramagnetic in nature, but valence bond theory could not explain the higher values of the magnetic moments. Okay. So there are so many limitations of the valence bond theory. That's why we want to discuss the next theory, to explain the nature of the bond between the metal and the ligand. So that theory is a crystal field theory. Actually, crystal field theory and valence bond theory developed on the same time. In 1927, the valence bond theory was developed. And crystal field theory was developed in 1930. According to the valence bond theory, the bond between the metal and the ligand, it is purely coordinate covalent. And crystal field theory also suggested the nature of the bond between the metal and the ligand. But as both the theories have developed on the same time, but crystal field theory was recognized after 20 years. It took 20 years to recognize by the peoples. Up to that time period, valence bond theory was the most popular theory. But as the valence bond theory could not explain certain properties of the complexes, there are certain limitations on the basis of the valence bond theory. So later on, crystal field theory was accepted. So let us see, what is the crystal field theory? So let us going to be discuss the basic aspects of the crystal field theory. Crystal field theory totally neglects the covalent bonding in coordination compounds or in complex compounds. As on the basis of the VBT, the nature of the bond between the metal and the ligand, it is covalent bond. But crystal field theory totally neglects this covalent bonding. On the basis of the VBT, this bond between the metal and the ligand, it is purely covalent bond or dative bond. But crystal field theory totally neglects this. So on the basis of the CFT, crystal field theory, complex is considered as an ionic model in which central metal ion is a positively charged species and it is surrounded by negatively charged ligands. As ligands carry the electrons, they are having the negative charge. And as central metal ion accepting the electron, it will carry the positive charge. So on the basis of the CFT, the central metal ion is surrounded by a negatively charged ligands. And central metal ion, it is a positively charged species. And ligand molecules or ions are the negatively charged species. Okay. So thus, on the basis of the CFT, metal ligand bonding is considered as purely ionic, because there is electrostatic force of attraction between the metal and the ligand. As ligands are negatively charged ion, metals are positively charged species. So positive negative attraction is there. That is electrostatic force of attraction between the metal ion and the ligand is there. That's why on the basis of the CFT, the bond between the metal and the ligand, it is purely ionic. Totally, it neglects the covalent bonding. The concept has been totally changed. According to the VBD, the ligand molecules are donating their electron pair to the metal. And there is a coordinate covalent bond between the metal and the ligand. But CFT totally cancels that concept. So on the basis of the CFT, the metal ions are considered as positively charged ions and ligands are considered as negatively charged ions. So CFT mainly concerned with interaction between, on the basis of the CFT, there is an interaction between the valence orbitals of the metal and surrounding ligand field. Okay. Now, if we consider the octahedral complex, there are six ligands around the central metal ion. And these six ligands create the ligand field around the central metal ion. So CFT mainly concerned with the interaction between the valence orbitals of the metal, particularly metal atom or ions having the d orbitals. So there is an interaction between the d orbitals of the metal with surrounding ligand field. Okay, with surrounding ligand field. Thus, it is clear that on the basis of the CFT, the bond between the metal and the ligand is purely ionic. There is an interaction between the central metal orbitals with surrounding ligand field. There is an interaction between the valence orbitals of the metal and the surrounding ligand field. The metal atom or ions are considered as positively charged species, and ligand molecules or ions are considered as negatively charged species. Thus, on the basis of the CFT, the bond between the metal and the ligand, it is purely ionic, purely electrostatic. Okay, it is purely ionic or purely electrostatic. Now, on the basis of the CFT, we are going to explain now the crystal field splitting. How the splitting of the orbital is takes place on the basis of the CFT. So it is clear that on the basis of the CFT, the bond between the metal and the ligand, it is purely ionic bond. Actually, on the basis of the VBT, the bond, it is purely covalent, purely coordinate covalent. But on the basis of the CFT, the bond between the metal and the ligand, it is purely ionic in nature, different type of the nature of the bond between the metal and the ligand.